I hope that wasn't too crude. Yeah. After the show, after our set anyway, John Hammond, John Paul Hammond, the knocked out blues right. guitarist and singer and harmonica player, real good guy too, came back and talked to us and was really enthused and really made us feel real welcome. And right afterwards, also David Bowie, and came back and we all ended up talking, you know, and had a real good time talking and found out about David's record collection, and which is a quite amazing one from what I understand. We both had a lot of the same real obscure people that we listened to, and there was a lot of good to it, you know. And as a result, I got asked to do something with David Bowie, mm-hmm. which turned out to be the Let's Dance album, which did a lot for us. You know, really had a blast making the record. I'm sorry, I'm long-winded. But through John Paul Hammond, he brought back a tape that he gave to his father, John Hammond, the man with the golden ears, as they say. And they forgot to mention his heart, you know. And he went to bat for us. Without a record deal, we went. He was waiting on the record. We went in with Jackson Browne, who we met the next night at the festival. We played in the bar under the casino where the main show is. And Jackson Browne and his band came down after their show and ended up sitting in the floor right in front of the stage. All of them lined up, and we played a ridiculous amount of time. We were like having fun. We played from I think 1:30 in the morning till 8 in the morning. And every jam you can imagine went on. And Jackson just said, look, when y'all come back, if you want to make a record, come to my studio. You can have it free tape, free everything. It ended up where we recorded our first album on his safety tapes for Liars in Love. Oh. And we didn't know that, but he went, yeah, here's the tape. Who cares? We got it, you know? And in 2 days, we had all the tracks. I'm so in love with you. it's always fun and it's always a challenge. However, there are those special days when it's effortless.
Yeah.
And that's when the chill bumps come. And that's not the only time, but that's especially when they come, because it's almost as if nothing you do is wrong. Probably the best thing you did in the first place was to, he showed me things at first playing music. Then he taught me to teach myself. Some ways a little more subtle than others. there was a time when I didn't get the message, and he said, if you ask me to show you anything else, I'm gonna kick your butt. And he did. But that was somewhere along the line. He didn't really go crazy on me or nothing. But it was more like kick your butt. You know? And any rivalry that we've ever had has been more it's been more helpful kind of rivalry, not a thing. It's been, what's this, you know? And then the other one goes, I better get off my can, you know? Let's go for it. I think there is a natural gift. However, you've got to be devoted to it. You've got to really, really work at developing that gift and making the most of it with every chance. Or it's abused, and then for one reason or another, it's lost, I think.
Come on, baby, light my fire. Come on, baby, light my fire. Try to set the night on fire.
The only way somebody could admit to themselves that they have a problem is self-admission. When did that happen?
When I realized that I had, this is a couple of years ago or so, when this part happened. I finally had resigned to the fact that I may be, or more than likely would be, stuck in a rut of drugs and alcohol for the rest of my life. I didn't realize that that probably meant a very short life. But I could not quit. I was serious in the grip of it, you know. Couldn't quit. I didn't know how to quit by myself, and I finally found out that you can't. You can cold turkey, but what that really involves is that you have a dry drunk going on, or a very resentful, mixed up person inside that just happens to be straight. And all those same pressures that are on a person like that are still there. You know, we started getting high in the first place to feel different, because we didn't like how we felt. And that's the reason it's important to get help, you know, because with help, with other people that are in the same situation and with an understanding of what addiction is, whether it be whatever kind of addiction, food, you know, drinking, anything, is there's other people that understand these things, and there needs to be actually like a psychic change, a personality change in the way you think, so that these problems can be dealt with and life can be met with, you know, on life's terms. If it becomes a problem within your life, please get help, because then what happens is you once again have the chance to work yourself into a place where that you can be back in touch with those people that you love and those people who love you, and that's what we're here for. When I heard him the first time, my brother had brought home a record that he had found in a trash can behind a radio. It was like a local kind of a bandstand kind of show,
right,
in Dallas.
Somebody just tossed
it. And they
it.
Just chunked the record because it wasn't, you know, pop music.
Yeah.
And He brought it home, put it on the turntable, and we both went, oh, what is this? You know? And from then on, we both had been very big fans of his. Now, the amazing part of it is, for me, is that a lot of the same people were a lot of other people's influences. It's just that Hendrix was not scared to take their influences and incorporate them in his music. Now, some people look at that as ripping people off. If it's done where you do the best you can with it, and it really is added to and comes out yourself, even if you're doing their song, if it's still got a new bite to it,
then it's,
you know, there seems to be a deal, for some reason, there seems to be more of a thing about playing, you know, it's like sacrilegious to play Jimi Hendrix's music or something, you know? And I think he would call bullshit on that, you know? I may be wrong, but I don't think so. Seems like he would want his music being out there just as accessible as anyone else's, you know? We'll be right back. next, the Live Alive album, we did a lot of that at Stevie Wonder Studio. We had needed another studio to work in, and someone had mentioned that a friend of mine that had been working with him before had mentioned that just call him up, you know, call him up. He's a regular guy, you know. And I'd met him at the Grammys once before, and he was really nice and funny and seemed real open and everything. So I called him. I called the studio up, and they gave us a better rate than anybody else had, and said, sure, just come in, block time, no problem. You know, so we kind of moved in and used his engineer and just kind of camped there for a while, you know, and it was a blast. And while we were doing it, he really liked how we had done the song. And so we asked him to do a cameo in the video. I've always liked his records all along, and had always liked that song in particular.
Superstition ain't the way. No, no. Do, do, no.
It's one thing to do a video. It's another thing, I would imagine, to act with a serious actor, you know. I would like to try it. I would like to be able to focus on it first, though.
You've been approached. I know Mickey Rourke has approached.
Mickey Rourke has asked me to. And it's, like I said, it's something that I want to try. I'm scared. I'm scared, Mickey. Help me out, guy. This is because I've never really learned how to put myself in that position. Now, through different areas of life, I guess what I have to do is just remember how I put myself in another situation in real life. And
relate to the situation.
And relate to that. Yeah. You know, I guess that's the real deal. Mm-hmm. I hope it is. Anyway, that's the only idea of how I've got to do it.
This commercial, because I haven't seen it yet, what exactly is it?
It was for a New Zealand-owned oil company that's all in New Zealand. And part of the thing was, see, there was Mitch Marsden and Murray Grinley. Had done a commercial with a girl named Brigitte for this oil company about a year and a half ago, or it was out for last year, and it was the three of them tooling around and hitchhiking around, and part of the commercial in an old pickup, just kind of bumming around all over New Zealand and having fun and singing this song, an acoustic guitar and a harmonica, and it was kind of like a in the vein of Sonny Terry, Brandon Meek kind of deal, yeah. You know. We don't know where we're going, we know where we've been, traveling on, you know. And they wanted to do it again and update it a little bit. So they asked me to do it, and they were going to have someone else in the commercial as well, another woman. We got over there, and I went to the agency to talk to the people about when the scheduling of everything was. I walked in with my fiance, Jana, who's from New Zealand, mm-hmm. but had been in the States with me for a little while. Walked in, and they said something about a companion. I said, well, here she is. And they went, wait a minute. They called over into the casting agency, and it wasn't like I said, you know, it had nothing to do with me saying it. It was, they hadn't found who they wanted, and she went and screen tested and got it, just like that. And they couldn't, you know, there was no reason why not to. There was we know each other, and it was to be my companion, you know. And it worked out real well. And she had a blast, and so did I, and so the whole thing was fun.
It's interesting to watch a guitar player when he's playing. the facial expressions. What's going, yeah, exactly, yeah. What's going through your mind when you're playing?
What you're playing?
Yeah.
And sometimes, I don't know, sometimes when your mind's not focused, it can be, you know, oh God, I wonder where my girlfriend is, or, you know?
I can't take it anymore, Stevie.
We all like to have fun. I figure if you can't have fun playing, something's wrong, you know? There are serious times, and I am serious about my music, but if there's not a fun side of it, then it's a job. And I like my job too much to make it be all the time, you know? And the band, we like each other, you know? We're like a family, for real, you know? It's not like a... It's not that we only see each other when we have to. We like to hang out together, and we like to mess with each other, and we like to be friends, and we like to stay close and help each other out. And that makes the whole deal a lot more fun.